The world has been in an abusive relationship since before we were all born. And now we all have until 2050 to break it up. The good news is that over the past few decades, we have seen large-scale deployment of renewable energy. And I actually just got back from COP27 in Sharm el-Sheikh, Egypt, and I'm pleased to report that governments and corporations are making major commitments to cut carbon emissions. But the bad news is, it's not enough. When we add up all the world's commitments, we see we're still on a path for humanity destroying level of climate change in this century. Try as we might, we have not been able to break it up with fossil fuels. And here's why. For over a century, fossil fuels have enabled economic growth, bringing billions of people out of poverty. But still today, almost 1 billion people lack access to basic electricity to power their lives. This means that we not only need to break up with fossil fuels, but we also need to double our overall energy supply. Climate leaders agree that we cannot achieve net zero emissions by 2050 unless we tackle the world's most polluting fossil fuel, coal. Here shows the concentration of carbon emissions from coal worldwide, which currently account for 40% of all carbon emissions from energy. Despite international agreements to phase down coal use, coal is booming. Each year, we are building more coal plants than we are shutting down. Even in places like Europe, which have had recent success shutting down coal plants, are beginning to turn the coal plants back on due to the global energy crisis in Europe. When rubber meets the road, politicians will choose to give their citizens heat, electricity, jobs, and economic benefits. This makes simply shutting down coal plants a non-viable option politically, economically, and practically, because the world needs more energy, not less. So what if we don't have to shut the coal plants down? Don't get me wrong, we need to stop burning coal. But what if we could simply replace the coal-fired boiler with a new emission-free heat source, such as advanced fission, fusion, or super hot rock geothermal? This means we could deliver clean, affordable, and reliable energy to billions of people worldwide while saving jobs, tax revenues, and the other economic benefits associated with these existing plants. But I know what you might be thinking. Why nuclear, and is it safe? So I'll start with the first question. Here's a map of Boston. I drew a red little square to demonstrate the relative size of that 1 gigawatt coal plant that you saw in the previous picture. So to replace the same amount of energy with renewables, such as solar in Boston, it would require the orange square of space in the summer and the yellow square in the winter. So it's easy to see why that might not be a feasible option in many areas. But what about nuclear energy? Being one of the most energy-dense technologies, it could easily fit within the existing footprint of the coal plant. But we're all wondering, is nuclear safe? So let's look at the facts. When we compare the deaths from nuclear energy to other energy sources we're all familiar with, we see, in fact, that nuclear is one of the most safe. While all technologies have risks, we happen to be really good at managing the risks of nuclear energy. We have empowered regulators whose sole job it is to protect the citizens they serve. And even nuclear waste, is only 94% of it can actually be reused, which means that it's not as big of a problem as we might have thought. And even that 6% that can't be reused, we're really good at managing it, ensuring that it will never do any harm. And also, we must think about this in the relative context. We are on a highway to climate hell. Nuclear is likely one of the fastest and most sustainable ways that we can decarbonize our global economy. So when we put it in that perspective, I believe that the benefits far outweigh the risks. And when we ask local coal plant communities, they agree, choosing that they'd rather repower with nuclear than see their coal plants and livelihoods shut down. But if you know anything about how nuclear projects are delivered today, you're probably thinking, don't they take a really long time, cost way too much, and have really high business risks due to uncertainty around schedules and budgets? And that is true. But luckily, quietly in the background, nuclear technology has been having a renaissance with incredible advances in fission and fusion that are notable due to the smaller size, modularity, increased safety, and reduced costs. But for this new generation of technologies to have any impact on climate change and energy poverty, we must completely transform how it is delivered. I'm here today representing a nonprofit called TEDxBoston. TEDxBoston has been anticipating this challenge and developing transformative solutions to make these projects happen fast and low cost, and most importantly, repeatably. Borrowing best practices from other industries, like how we deliver data centers, as well as renewable projects, using standardized designs and a manufactured built approach. So let's see how this could work in practice. We already have the transmission lines. We have the turbines, the generators, the cooling systems. We can use thermal energy storage to de-link the safety case between the existing coal plant and the new heat source, meaning that the existing coal plant can operate as normal. And then we can use seismic isolation to remove any need for site-specific bespoke engineering. That way we can create a standardized set of designs that can work for every coal plant site in the world. Think about it as an IKEA kitchen. You can buy an IKEA kitchen to fit any space and know it will have a designated place where the heat source will go. You can choose between a technology that exists today or that will come online maybe at the end of 2020. And we can use the power of automated project development processes to make sure that these projects can happen at speed and scale. TEDxBoston is recruiting and building a global consortium of key stakeholders to ensure that this vision can become a reality. And if we are successful in delivering hundreds of these projects between now and 2050, what we can achieve is truly extraordinary. This is what I like to call the double black diamond ski slope of decarbonization. We could see 40% reduction in carbon emissions from energy, making it the single largest carbon reduction opportunity on the planet. And best part is, we don't have to stop there. We can use the same best practices to repower gas plants, and then to produce clean synthetic fuels and hydrogen to replace oil and gas in hard to decarbonize sectors. So I hope you'll join me and TEDxBoston in repowering coal by 2050 and getting the world back on track to net zero. Thank you.